you guys having any fun yet? Okay, good. I wanted you to know we can, even though we don't have a lot of money, we can still throw a pretty good party. So I know you didn't come up here and stand and have all this fun to hear me, so without further ado, I'm going to give you a man who's been a distinguished fighter for liberty over the course of his career in Congress, been a great advocate for it over the last year or so on the campaign trail running for president, and has actually given us the next generation and has done his duty with a terrific United States Senator and his son Rand Paul. So without further ado, Congressman Ron Paul.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Great to be here. Friendly people. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Pat, thank you for that introduction. Thank you for that very nice welcome. A lot of Friends of Liberty in this town. That's great. Well, when I came here, I heard Kurt sort of won a little election, a nomination today. That was very nice. Can we congratulate Kurt? So it is nice to be here. You know, 5 years ago when I first started doing a little bit of campaign nationally, I have to confess, you know, I didn't know what to expect in Minnesota. I had no idea. But I didn't have this idea that it was, you know, so receptive to the freedom message. So let me tell you how delighted I am for the many times I've come back over the last 5 years. Receptions have always been just great. So congratulations for joining the revolution. This past week, I spent it in Washington. They guess what bill we were working on? National Defense Authorization Act. And I tell you what they did, there was a lot of, they say it needs a lot of compromise in Washington. Unfortunately, they had a lot of compromise in Washington this week, and they didn't do the right things. They actually made the bill worse. Where some of this arresting by the military was recommended, or it should be, now they must do it on some of these arrests. And we had the up and down vote on the amendment to strike that provision where the U.S. military is permitted and encouraged to arrest American citizens, not given a trial, and held indefinitely. And we couldn't even win that vote. We had about 180 vote with us on that, so it is, you know, there's a growing number. But there was one vote that had to do with ending the war. I assume there's plenty of people here who would like to see us end a few wars and get our troops at home. We had one vote that came up again. It was at the last year. We had a pretty good vote on it to say, look, it's time to get busy, make a plan, get out of there, and you have to be out in a year or so or whatever it was. And last year, we lost that vote only by a small. So guess what happened this year? They wouldn't allow us to bring it up because they knew we could win this vote. There was a great coalition of conservative Republicans and Democrats that came together on this issue that it was time to come in. So a lot of people say, well, Ron Paul, what are you doing? You don't seem to want to compromise. Well, I'll tell you what. You don't need to compromise if you're doing the wrong thing. You have to stand on your principles and get more people to agree with you. We had another compromise this week. It's called the Export-Import Bank. And I think it was $390 billion. I can't believe it was that big. So it was a big article in the Washington papers today saying, maybe there's a new time coming. They're working together now, Republicans and Democrats, both towards corporate welfare. So this isn't what needs to be done. We need to have people come together, and I've argued the case that we do come together together in the defense of liberty and bring people together, whether liberals or conservatives or modest Republicans at all, come together and do the right thing. You know, why don't we just come together and all obey the Constitution? That would be a unique idea. But this week on the vote on the Ex-Im Bank reminds me of one of the very early votes we had after Ronald Reagan was elected president in 1981. This came up, and there was a coalition of the Republicans and the conservative Democrats were working together, and they were cutting things. Most of the time was cutting the proposed increases, but anyway, it looked like things were getting cut. So I can remember one congressman getting up. He's, all right, you guys are cutting all this good welfare, all the welfare benefits. What we need to do is cut some corporate welfare. So he proposed that we cut, you know, a large percentage of the Export-Import Bank. And it passed by over 100 votes. And I thought, wow, maybe we're on to something here. Maybe there will be a real difference in the 80s. And yet there was a lot of talk afterwards, and people who really were concerned about it got together, and they said, we can reverse this. We're going to reverse this vote. And the next day they had it. 100 people changed their votes and changed it and put the money back in. And I recall, this is so typical of what happens in Washington. The Washington Post was interviewing one member. He says, well, you voted to cut it yesterday, and today you voted to put it back in. He says, does that mean your vote is up for sale? And the congressman, with a straight face, says, no, but it's up for rent. But that's about it. And that's why we need people of principle that will stand. And that's why I was, of course, very biased. I was glad to see my son win. Remark I made being back, having been on the campaign trail for so long, I said, you know, being in D.C., this is depressing. You know, I said, I need to go to Minnesota and get cheered up. And this is where I have hope. Visiting with groups like you and visiting the college campuses, you've heard me say many times, there is a revolution in ideas going on. And it isn't a narrow revolution. It isn't just sort of a conservative group of the Republican Party. It's much, much bigger than this. I am convinced that, you know, we have a good support in the Republican Party for this liberty ideas. But I am also convinced from traveling around the country, from the people I talked to, going through airports, that I am convinced for every vote we get in the Republican primaries, there's at least two out there that are independent or even Democrats who will look at these serious principles of limited government and personal liberty, less war, and doing something with the Federal Reserve System. We don't know when that's coming, but it will come because it's a non-viable system. Let me tell you, fiat money always ends, so that it will end. I would like to see a smooth ending to it. That means I'd like to legalize competition, like legalize the Constitution, and let us have gold and silver currency. But why that issue has been so important to me is not only it fascinates me about monetary policy, but it is also related to our personal liberties. It relates to the Constitution. It relates to personal liberties. It explains how you can get away with financing without direct taxation. It's indirect taxation. So therefore, the entitlement welfare state grows, and also the warfare state grows too, and nobody quite sees who pays for it, because they can run up the debt, we can borrow, and the Fed prints the money to buy the debt. The people who suffer are invisible. They don't know exactly the ones. But I believe the people are waking up now to the fact that the elderly suffer, the middle class suffers, the unemployed suffer. And it's all related to the fact that there are very powerful special interests behind the Federal Reserve. And guess what? It wasn't the middle class that got the bailouts. It was the big guys who had made a lot of money, and they got the bailouts. But ultimately, the real reason is that when government grows, your liberties are diminished. Whether it's diminished through what they put in the National Defense Appropriation Act, Authorization Act, whether it's the Patriot Act or whatever they're doing to do these good things for you, none of it can be financed without the shenanigans through the Federal Reserve System. So as government gets bigger, your liberties are diminished. And that is what government should be all about. Government should be very limited. And we should know it precisely what the government should be there for. And the founders knew this. And it is not to manage the entitlement system. It is not meant to police the world. It was there to protect our liberties against any encroachment. I think what has happened in the last 4 or 5 years with the discovery of the recession that had been predicted by a few people, but it was an eye opener for a lot of people. Yeah, the debt is too bad. The recession is very bad. It's probably a lot worse than the government is admitting. The unemployment rate is much bigger than ever. But now people are starting to say there's something deeply flawed with the system, and if they're not on the take, the people are sick and tired of it. And I am delighted that there are so many, and especially the whole generation, that are talking about this. And for this reason, I remain an optimist on this, precariously so, because I have to go to Washington every once in a while, and I have to listen to that. But governments reflect with the people. It might surprise you, but most members of Congress don't have deeply held beliefs. Can you imagine that? No, they aren't. But their ideas are more or less to how do you stay in office? Well, it's up to us to say how you stay in office is you do this, A, B, and C, and you obey the Constitution, and then they'll pay more attention. If not, then you replace them. But the big issue is personal liberty. I've talked about it a lot, and for so many years now, probably 100 years, we've taken liberty and we've chopped it into pieces. Some people talk about economic liberty and some talk about personal liberty. Why isn't it one and the same? It's the same thing. If you have a right to your life and a right to your values, a right to your church, a right to read your own books, you should have a right to your own body, what you put in your own body, and you ought to have a right to spend your money the way you want as well. Now, I'm reminded by something I saw in the audience here just a minute ago that we will know when the Republic is returned to us. That is, you'll be allowed to drink raw milk whenever you want to. And also, if you want to make rope out of hemp, you'd be allowed to make rope out of hemp once again. But it is the personal liberty and responsibility, and we've had a grand test in this country. It was the greatest test ever in the history of mankind. We had the wealthiest country ever, but we are not the wealthiest. If we think we are, we're fooling ourselves, because the apparent wealth is based on debt. We are the biggest debtor. That is our problem. We live way beyond our means. The entitlement system is deeply flawed morally and constitutionally and economically, so it has to go. And believe me, this idea that we can police the world and tell other people how to live and think we can afford it, we can. I think we have an obligation maybe to influence the world with our good values by practicing them and setting an example where other countries would want to emulate us. So our message is great. It's an American message. It does need to be renewed. It is revolutionary in the sense of an intellectual revolution and nonviolence. But we can change it by changing people's mind, and that is what's happening. So there's every reason to be optimistic about what is happening in the country. But it also means that if you have discovered exactly what's going on and the need changes, we need you active, because you're in a minority. If you take the whole state right now, you're still in a minority, but you have a lot to say about it, and you're influenced by ideas. And so that is the role. Everybody has a role to play, and nobody knows exactly what it'll be. It might be helping somebody to get elected to the Senate and running for elections and supporting other people, teaching or whatever, but there's always a role. But I think the most important thing is try to understand how the world works. I feel grateful that I became curious in the 50s and the 60s. How does this thing work? You know, what is the plain truth of things? And for years and years, I tried to understand it. And I think that's the most important thing, that the information is available to us. In the 50s and the 60s, there's no internet. It was hard to find these books. There were hardly any professors. Today, there's a lot of professors teaching about what true liberty is and what the economic problems are. So the information is out there, and in some ways, you should be uncomfortable enough that you will pursue it, because I think the burden is greater on you who know what the problems are, and you know the answers, you study them, and you can offer it, and you won't have to worry exactly what you have to do, because somebody will make use of your talents. That is what I encourage, and to be grateful that we still have a country, that we can still get together and have elections and work together. So this, to me, is still wonderful, and we see a revival on something I think has made this country great. And if we pursue this, I think it will give us the greatest chance for peace and prosperity in America. Thank you. Thank you.
All of you know that the congressman